Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Chef's Secret, a novel by Crystal King. Read by Jacques Roy. Chapter 1. Giovanni. Roma, April 14, 1577. Word traveled fast at the Vaticano, even during the darkness of night. Within an hour of Bartolomeo Scappi's passing, serving women from all over the palazzo had come to the chef's bedside, crying for the man they had loved and respected. They keened and wept, tearing at their hair, their skin and clothing, their wails filling the gilded halls. Francesco Reynoso, the Vaticano Scalco, ordered the staff to bring candles, and soon they filled the room with their glow, lighting up the shadows and illuminating the faces of the mourners. As papal steward, Francesco always kept things in order, even when his best friend was before him on the bier. I sat in the corner and watched, lost and helpless, as two of the kitchen servants helped my mother, Caterina, and her maid bathe and dress my late uncle Bartolomeo. Of course, these women needed not take on this macabre task. The servants who reported to Francesco were more than capable, but they insisted, such was their love for my uncle. The heavy odor of rosewater hung in the air as they perfumed Bartolomeo's skin. It broke my heart to breathe in the scent. It was a smell he had loved, using the floral essence to flavor thousands of dishes in his kitchen. For the last 11 of my 30 years, I had worked as an apprentice to Bartolomeo. A lion of a man who spent his days fussing over pots of boiling meats, scribbling elaborate seating arrangements on thin parchment, directing kitchen servants on which pies to bake and how many ducks to cook. Being related to Bartolomeo Scappi was a great honor. As the celebrated private chef to several popes, he was lauded in circles all over Italy, and countless cardinali, nobles, kings, and queens had fallen under the spell of his cuisine as I had. I always thought him invincible. And he had been, until 5 days passed, when sickness broke his spirit and laid him low. During his illness, I eschewed my duties in the kitchen and remained by his side, ever my uncle's braccio destro, his right hand, as he often referred to me. He was more to me than my maestro. He was also the father I never had, my own having died of plague before I was born. To see him stretched out before me, his eyes closed, his skin so pale and cold, seemed inconceivable. Giovanni, Francesco said, laying a hand on my shoulder, we are ready to move him. I nodded my assent and watched with a heavy heart as 8 men lifted Bartolomeo's body onto a stretcher to carry him to the nearby Cappella Sistina, where the vigil would continue. I followed. As I entered the chapel adorned with breathtaking frescoes of the pagan sibyls and figures of the Old Testament, I thought how fitting it was for my uncle to lie beneath the magnificent paintings of Michelangelo. A man he once called friend. Throughout the night and into the early morning, everyone the chef knew came to the chapel to pay their respects, light a candle, and share their condolences. Relief flooded through me when Valentino arrived. He was my dearest friend and knew me better than any other. When I was 9 and my mother had decided she was tired of Tivoli and moved us to Roma, I came to know Valentino Pio de Carpi and we became friends despite our difference in station. One of Valentino's great uncles was Agostino Chigi, the famously wealthy Roman banker. Between the Chigi wealth on his mother's side and the riches of the Carpi family on his father's, Valentino was a man who would want for nothing in his life. But the money had never mattered to Valentino. He loved me like a brother, and I him. I caught his eye as he entered the chapel, which was full of flickering candlelight that illuminated the frescoes covering the walls and ceiling. I had been in the cappella dozens of times, but always during the day. At night, it held a strange magic that was difficult to explain. The paintings seemed larger, the saints even more beautiful and imposing. I was glad Pope Gregory had allowed special dispensation for the chapel's use. How Francesco had managed it, I did not know and did not ask. My best friend lived in a magnificent palazzo not far from the Vaticano. His mother, Serafina, accompanied him, the shadow of her cloak masking most of her face. Valentino led her through the ornate, gilded door in the marble screen at the end of the chapel and across the black and white circles of tile. I stood to greet him. Gio, oh Gio, we came as soon as we heard. Valentino shook his head as he neared, his long, dark hair falling into his eyes. Your sorrow is my sorrow. He pulled me close in a strong hug. Thank you for coming, I said. Francesco sent for you? Yes, God bless that man, always making sure the world is running, even when his own heart must be breaking. Serafina pushed past her son and enveloped me in an embrace, her frail arms full of surprising strength. She smelled like lavender. I loved your uncle, she whispered in my ear. He never failed to make me smile. Her tears wet the collar of my vest. As she pulled away, her hood slid back to reveal her soft, elegant features, which still held a hint of the beauty she must have been. I was thankful for her compassion. A boy of Valentino's standing should not have befriended an apprentice like me. But Serafina never blinked an eye, accepting me graciously into their home and their lives. It was part of what made me love her so much. She was generous almost to a fault, caring for her servants as though they were family, never minding what the rest of the aristocracy thought. Valentino glanced over to where Bartolomeo lay. How is your mother doing? My mother sat next to her brother, staring at his silent form, her fingers rubbing her rosary beads. She had been close to Bartolomeo, and if my grief felt like weights upon me, I could not imagine how much heavier was the burden she bore. As well as can be, I said. You know how close they were. Valentino put a hand on his mother's shoulder. Go to her, Mamma. She told me once how much she admired you. Perhaps you can give her comfort. Serafina nodded and walked away, wiping her eye with the back of her glove just before she put a hand on my mother's shoulder. The two women held each other and sobbed. Valentino smiled a little. Women are always adept with tears, are they not? Agreed, but so am I today. They are honorable tears for an honorable man. But what happened? How could he have become so sick? I shivered. The doctor said Bartolomeo was no force against la polmonita. His lungs would not clear. Valentino lowered his head. Today is a dark day. You'll bury him at Alla Regola? Yes, of course, a gravelly voice answered him from behind. Virgilio Bossi, one of Bartolomeo's dearest friends, the man who first helped him find work in Roma. The Chiesa of Santi Vincenzo e Anastasio alla Regola was the guild church of the Company of Cooks and Bakers, of which Virgilio had been maestro since before I was old enough to walk. His personality was bold, a match to Bartolomeo's, and his hair and beard always appeared wild and slightly unkempt. The burly man clasped me on the shoulder. There could be no other resting place for someone as celebrated as Bartolomeo Scappi. Your uncle's service to the guild will be greatly missed. We will honor his legacy as befitting. Virgilio's wife, Simona, dabbed her red and puffy eyes with a fringed handkerchief. When she saw Bartolomeo's body, she let out a cry, rushed to his side, and threw herself upon his supine form. Her sobs came in gulping gasps. My mother and Serafina moved to comfort her. Dio mio, Virgilio swore. He leaned in to me and Valentino, lowering his voice. Forgive her dramatics. She has been distraught since she heard the news. Your uncle, may he rest in peace. He could charm the ladies, could he not? I could not help but chuckle, especially when Valentino made his own snort of laughter. More than one noblewoman had mooned after the charismatic cook. That he did. I swallowed hard. Tell me, Virgilio, what needs to be done for the procession and the funeral? I am at a loss. Virgilio grew serious. Do not worry about a thing. It's all taken care of. I arranged it with Bartolomeo years ago. Even the marble has been inscribed. My mind reeled with the thought of my uncle so prepared that the marble of his headstone was already engraved. I shut my open mouth, working to regain my composure. What do you mean? Virgilio unfastened the button of his cloak, and a servant appeared at his elbow to take it from him. Gio, your uncle is one of the most important men in our entire company. He deserves a fine procession and a grand funeral. the guild is honored to send him off to God like the king of cooks he was. Virgilio was right. Bartolomeo would have wanted a grand show. He was the master of spectacle. To imagine less for him at the end seemed unthinkable. "Thank you," I managed, choking back another bout of tears. We discussed the arrangements. Virgilio suggested that members of the guild with the closest relationship to Bartolomeo should carry the bier in the procession. He had already sent men to the chiesa to cut the marble floor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.